Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Too often, it seems that we are coming off a disappointing week for the Flames lately, and this is another one. As always, I'm Dan alongside Matt. What do you think about this week in general, Matt?
Well, Calgary has been showing some inconsistency in efforts from period to period and game to game, and you can see that in the results. One win out of three games, and all three of those contests should have been games that the Flames should have won.
Well, you know, it's funny. I mean, if we look back to a month ago, you know, this time in December, December 25th, the Flames had won pretty much every game except for two by that point in the month. And they were flying high. They were looking great. And now, as we said, January was really going to be a telling sign of where this team's at. And January hasn't looked so great this far. And I think that we're really seeing that the Flames really aren't the powerhouse team I think that we all wanted them to be.
No. And the fact that they've only got, I do believe, 5 wins this month, they needed to have 8 or 9 by the end of the month in order to really attack the top teams in our division and cement themselves in a playoff spot. And the fact that they're 6 or 7 points out now, 9 behind San Jose, it's getting to the point where even if they win 4 or 5 in a row, they still won't make up enough ground to actually get back into the playoff picture.
Yeah, I'm counting 4 wins so far this month, and 4 losses if you include the shootout loss to Edmonton. So really, if you look at it that way, we're about 500 this month.
And that's not good enough, especially because this was the easy month of the three that were remaining.
Yeah, well, that's true. It's the easy month, and there's a lot less hockey to be played most weeks. Like, you know, you look at this coming week, and we got 2 games.
Mm-hmm.
So after this, it gets tough. But, you know, at least there's a team now between us and Edmonton as a buffer, and we're tied with Winnipeg. But in the official standings, Winnipeg is 7th, so we've got a bit of a buffer there.
Yeah. It'll be interesting to see how things go over the next couple of weeks, especially as we get towards the trade deadline. If Calgary continues to waffle a bit and win a game, lose a game, I don't see the Flames being in a situation where they don't pull the trigger and start moving out a bunch of bodies.
And, you know, we've talked in the past about how close the league is this year and how that's going to affect the trade deadline. And I really think that the closeness of the league is doing us a favor of still giving the Flames hope. Because if you look at about this time last year and where teams were and in a usual year with the amount of points we have, I mean, we would be out of the playoff race without a hope.
Oh, for sure. We would be 10, 15, 20 points out by now. And instead, we're only 5 or 6 that out at the moment.
Yeah, so I think it's working in our favor in some ways to give the team and the fans hope. But, you know, I think in the end, I don't know about you, I'm kind of resigned to the fact that we won't be having postseason hockey in Calgary this year.
I'm in that same boat. A team that makes the playoffs, you have to have some consistency in your game. Even if you're not very talented, as long as you're bringing it every night. And we saw that last year with the Flames. We weren't very talented, but every night it was a hard-working effort, and they'd put it all out there. We saw against Carolina yesterday where, like, for the first half of the game, the Flames didn't even show up. And then they turned it on in the late part of the second period and the third, and by then it was too late.
Well, let's break down the week and talk about each one of those games and the efforts. The first game of the week since we talked last was the game on Tuesday when the Flames took on the New Jersey Devils. And, you know, I don't know about you, I wasn't too impressed by the first period, but coming out with a 1-1 tie, not too bad. And as soon as the Lee Stempniak goal happened, I had a feeling that New Jersey was going to take over that game.
Yeah, and they did, and the Flames attempted to come back, but New Jersey, the only reason why they're even in the playoff conversation is because of their stifling defense. So if you give them the lead, you're pretty much done. And the Flames spotted him another goal almost right after the Stempniak goal. And you're not likely going to come back against New Jersey from two down.
No, and I mean, New Jersey's not a team we get to see play very often. And I don't watch a lot of hockey that's not Flames hockey, I'll be honest. But I thought it was quite interesting to watch the game because they play such a different style. They play a very defensive style. And they knew exactly what they had to do to keep our guys out of the shooting lanes.
Mm-hmm. And New Jersey's very good at shutting down the opposition. They're very similar to their teams from like 15, 20 years ago where it was trap central and very good at limiting any offense whatsoever. And if you look at their stat sheet, they only have five players that are legitimate scorers on the team, and like everybody else has less than a dozen points. So they don't really have a huge amount of offense. It's their strength is shutting the other teams down. Like when Lee Stempniak and Mike Camilleri are your two leading scorers, that's not good.
No, it's not. And both guys, incidentally, on the score sheet, both former Flames, and both of them were on the score sheet that game.
Mm-hmm.
Lee Stempniak was actually the third star of the game and got the second period goal, and Camilleri assisted. Camilleri's got, I think, 20. Yeah, he's doing quite well this year.
Mm-hmm.
And he and Stempniak look like they're a good team, but you're right. I mean, when Stempniak is one of your lead scorers, it looks like you're having a rough year.
Yeah.
But good for him for stepping up, though.
Yeah. And how bad does that trade with Vancouver look now, sending Corey Schneider to the Devils for the pick that ended up becoming Bo Horvat? No slight to Horvat, but Schneider's developed into one of the top goalies in the NHL.
Well, and, you know, I used to like watching New Jersey to see Brodeur play. And, you know, for a long time, I couldn't really tell you besides Scott Stevens and Brodeur anyone on that team. And I think after Brodeur retired, they've really been looking for that next cornerstone goalie. And you're right, I think Schneider's run with that and really taken that role. And I can see him being there as their starter for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's interesting, and we'll talk about this with later on as well, but I think we're seeing Vancouver doing a lot of what Edmonton's doing, where some of the best goaltenders are coming through Edmonton and flourishing when they leave, and we're seeing that from Vancouver now too.
Yeah, well, both Schneider and Luongo have been pretty good this year.
Well, and even Eddie Lack in the game that we'll talk about in just a minute here.
True.
So the Devils game, the Flames didn't win, unfortunately. Shots were pretty close, but yeah, they... Would you say that the compete effort was there from the Flames? To me, it looked to me like they were not even playing at 80%.
No, and that's part of the Flames' problem with consistency. They're not... Like, last year, you would see them throwing everything at the opposition. They might not win every game, but you could see that they were at least putting everything out on the ice. This year, between periods, it's not even the same effort level, so you don't really know what you're going to get from the opening faceoff in each period, let alone each game.
And this is what we're seeing at the beginning of this season, too. I mean, if you think back to September, October, we were really seeing this team who would have good bursts. They'd, you know, get excited by something. Maybe they were ahead or they had a good hit or something like that, and they would get this burst of energy. But then they were quickly frustrated, and, you know, we'd let the other team get ahead on us or something would happen, and the Flames just looked like they would run out of gas very quickly.
Yeah.
And to me, these games are looking a lot like the games in the first month of the
season. And that's why I think it's going to be a tall order for the Flames to get back into the playoff hunt. Like, if you discount that 7-game winning streak, the Flames have been pretty mediocre all season. So the fact that they had one hot stretch, the team itself seems to be just a mediocre average team that's just getting through game to game, not terrible, like, not Buffalo Sabres bad last year, but not exactly good either.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, they look like where they need to be, and we've talked about this before, but they look like a team who's in the middle of a rebuild. And there's work to be done, obviously.
For sure. And rebuilding is not linear, and players struggle. It is what it is. Just have to identify the weaknesses in the offseason and try to fill them, sort of like last season when we got Frolik and Hamilton, trying to address the whole Corsi poorness issue from a year ago. And
remembering that there's only so much we can do every offseason, and it's going to take a couple years to build the team we need.
And that will come through quality drafting and free agency and trades. So it'll take time. Just have to be patient. Like, if it was a linear process, Edmonton would be at the top of the standings by now. And we see that they're still behind us, so...
It's true. We move on to the second game of the week against one of the few teams in the NHL that has a worse record than we do, and that was the Columbus Blue Jackets. And this was a game I thought was a pretty good Flames game. Not a great game, but a pretty good Flames game from the beginning of the first right through the end of the third, and we ended up taking this one in a 4-2 win. We got outshot by Columbus, but we played a better game. And I was glad to see Michael Frolik get an early goal here. He's been out for a while, so he's got to make up some points there. And another good game from Sam Bennett, as he got two goals in this game. And I don't know what was wrong with the kid for so long in this season, but it looks like he's really come back around.
Well, back when he was in that middle of that streak, I remember saying that once he got one of those goals to go in, he'd go on a huge run, like scoring 10 goals in 10 games or something like that. And it seems that I was correct. And once he actually got the monkey off his back, he's just been putting him in left, right, and center. He was doing a lot of the things correctly. It just the bounces weren't going his way when he was on his 18 game scoreless drought. Like, he hit the post so many times, the goalie would rob him. Like, there's not much you can do.
No, there's not. We've seen in this game, in the Columbus game, and other games as well, but Michael Backlund is frequently getting the assist on Bennett goals. And I don't know about you, but I think that Backlund might have a new sort of lease on life as a Flame now that he and Bennett are working so well together. I know for a while people were saying, maybe it's time to move Backlund. And, of course, the price is right, you do, but I think maybe he's being looked at as that number two guy for the Bennett line for next year.
It's entirely possible. It will depend on how the Flames view Bennett long term. If they view him as a center, I think that Backlund still may be moved, but they do seem to have some good chemistry. And anytime that you have a young player like Bennett, it's always good to stick him with a couple of good defensive forwards. And both Backlund and Frolik, now that Frolik's back, having those guys on the line with Bennett allows him some more freedom to attempt some stuff that he wouldn't otherwise.
Yeah, you could be right. I think he's getting comfortable with this team too, and I guess by team I mean his line, but they just look a lot more comfortable in general, the three of them as well.
Mm-hmm.
Overall thoughts on the Columbus game?
For me, I thought it looked like a game between two teams that were in the bottom five of the standings. I thought it was a pretty sloppy effort by both sides. Yeah, the Flames were better, but
it wasn't the complete 60-minute game we needed, but I thought the effort over 60 was much better than it was against New Jersey.
Yeah, and it's a lot easier to beat up on a team that's terrible. And the Flames, like, even if they weren't playing at their top level, they would probably still skate away with the 2 points. It's just, there was still some overall sloppiness in their game, and the fact that Columbus was actually tied with the Flames after 2 periods was a little bit concerning, just because of the fact that Columbus isn't a very good hockey team.
Yeah, I mean, I think they've gotten better with the addition of Seth Jones, especially on the blue line. I've always liked Dubinsky. I've thought that he's a good player. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, you're right. I mean, their roster, if you look at it, is very much like the Flames. They're made up of spare parts and some young prospects.
Yeah. They're just not quite – they're very similar to the 13-14 edition of the Flames, where their young guys are really raw and there's not really much in between.
Yeah, so. I mean, I like some of the young guys that we're seeing come out, but they're definitely not at the level where the Flames are. I think only Seth Jones, you could say, is really that big star prospect.
Yeah. And, like, when the Flames, in that particular year, it was pretty much just Monahan that was the top young guy. So, yeah, they'll have a long way to go still.
For sure. And the last game of the week, another one that I thought the Flames could win, playing against the Carolina Hurricanes. And the Canes have been hot lately. They're not in a great spot in the standings, but they've been hot. And this was, an interesting game to watch. I think that the first period of this game, when the Canes got two from Rask and Lindholm, this might have been the worst period of Flames hockey we've seen this season. What do you think?
Pretty much. The Flames, other than that one good chance where the Lyles turned the puck over to Hudler in front of the net, and Hudler had like four shots on the play, I thought Calgary, that was, yeah, it was not a good period at all.
They were sloppy and disorganized, and they didn't seem like they had any plan of attack.
No, and when you're getting thumped by the Hurricanes, you know you're not having a good day.
And I thought it was interesting, too. I mean, if you look, they had 2 days off before the Hurricanes game, so I thought we were going to see a team that at least at the beginning came out looking rested.
Yeah, but they looked tired.
They looked like they were on game two of a back-to-back.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes me worried about what we're going to see tonight in Dallas.
Which, that's a little... Yeah, exactly. And especially traveling 1,700 kilometers from Raleigh to Dallas in between the games, no, that shouldn't be too encouraging for tonight.
But looking at the Hurricanes game, it was a 5-2 Hurricanes win for the final score. The Flames got a goal from Hudler, which was nice to see him back on the scoreboard. Hopefully this will be sort of like Bennett, where that'll open the floodgates. And they got a goal from Colborne, and Granlund also got a point on that along with Brody. I don't think that there's really much good we can say about this one.
No.
The Flames started looking better in the second. I thought they did a good job of clogging up some of the shooting lanes and, you know, taking away some of the opportunities in the second. But by that point, it was too little too late.
Yeah. I'm actually going to be curious to see what Carolina does over the next month, especially if they do push their way into a playoff spot, because they have quite a few unrestricted free agents that I don't think they were intending on bringing back, like Eric Staal and Cam Ward. And the fact that they've only made the playoffs once since they won the Cup, it'll be interesting to see, even if they are in a playoff spot, will they pull the trigger on moving out the 7 or 8 UFAs that they have?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I mean, Ron Francis doesn't have a huge body of work to tell us what he'd usually do. It's not like a Brian Burke or somebody that we've seen year after year. So, yeah, I don't know what Francis plans to do.
And I have to say that Victor Rask is... I was actually surprised at how good of a player he was, considering that this is only his second season in the NHL. He looks like he'll end up being a good one for Carolina.
You know, I was really surprised how good Eddie Lack looked. I mean, you know, I think Lack kept Carolina in the game, but definitely kept Calgary out of this game. Calgary, I think, should have had a couple more goals, especially in the second when they started really having some of the good chances.
Mm-hmm. I agree. If Lack was just having an okay game, I think the Flames end up walking away with 2 points.
If I was an uneducated hockey fan who didn't know that Eddie Lack was the backup, I would have thought he was the starter for this team.
Mm-hmm. Oh, for sure. And especially considering Lack's prior performances, he was not very good coming into last night. And, like, he was basically has the same stat line as Hiller does. So the fact that he had such a quality effort was both a surprise and unexpected for the Flames.
Well, and I think, you know, as we were talking about earlier, he came out of that Vancouver system, and he's looked a lot better since he left that Vancouver system. And I think Lack probably sees an opportunity. You know, you'd mentioned Cam Ward is likely leaving at the end of the year, and I think maybe Lack is thinking this might be his job, especially if they're going into a bit of a rebuild, might be his job to win.
Mm-hmm. And I could definitely see that. Like, if you look at the Flames going through our rebuild, Kari Rommel's kind of been the guy all the way through. So Lack could see the a similar opportunity that Rommel had with us in Carolina. Especially as they don't really have anybody else in the organization that's coming up immediately. They have a couple of decent prospects, but they're still like in the Mason McDonald, John Gillies timeline, so like not ready for another 2 or 3 years at least.
I'm pretty sure Carolina gave up a third and a seventh round pick for Lack, and if so, that looks like a good deal.
Yeah. Oh, I agree.
I think really when I look at this game, I think the biggest thing you can say, and even when the Flames started putting the pressure on late in the game against the Hurricanes, it was that the Hurricanes were capitalizing on their power play chances and the Flames weren't.
Well, that's pretty much been the Flames' MO for most of the season.
Yeah, you're right, but I think more so in this game than any. I mean, you know, I don't think Carolina earned 5 goals. Like, you know, I think
no.
that...
no,
and
I
think,
agree.
And I think the Flames should have had more than 2, but I think it was just that special teams play that in this game especially...
Well, when you have 4 power plays like Calgary did, when you don't even register a shot mm-hmm. on any of them, that's terrible.
Yeah, I mean, we were 0-for-5, and Carolina was 1-for-5, but even though they didn't score, they were using that man advantage better than we were.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it really deflates any momentum you have when you're getting 8 minutes of power play time and 0 shots. Like, it's hard to go out on the shifts after the penalty and try to score after that. Especially when you didn't get anything accomplished whatsoever when you did have the opportunity.
And, I mean, the special teams is something that we saw the Flames have an issue with last year as well. So I really think going forward, even more than maybe a personnel change, like bringing in different players, this is something the Flames have to figure out how are they going to improve it going forward.
Well, to be fair, since December, the Flames have their power play has been in the top 15. It's just... It struggled yesterday, and it was like a noticeably bad struggle, not just, oh, we went 0-for-5, but it was a terrible 0-for-5.
Yeah, no, and you're right that it's come back since December, for sure, but again, just like we've talked about with the wins, it's not a consistent effort.
No, and that is one of the things that Calgary will have to improve.
And you have to be ready that when you get that man advantage, you can capitalize on it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the whole consistency thing is part of a big issue together. I'm not exactly sure what that issue is, but I think when we can get more consistent wins, we'll get better power plays. Like, I think it's just an effort level thing.
Yeah, well, I think the main problem that the Flames are having is having too many good power play defensemen. Like, usually most teams have 1 or 2 guys that are your power play quarterbacks. The Flames have 5 players that can slot in to that position. And trying to get the right chemistry to work is been a little bit of a problem this year. Like, especially like if you look at a guy like Dougie Hamilton, when he was with Boston, he was on their first power play unit, and that's how he got 40 points last year. Very similar to Dennis Wideman and his career year with the Flames last year. But you also have Brody and Giordano who are really good, and it just makes it a little more difficult when you have too many cooks in the kitchen.
Yeah, you could be right. Another note about the Hurricanes game is Michael Ferlin sat this one out. He got a concussion during the Blue Jackets game. And Lance Boma, we've said this before, but we welcome Lance Boma back to the lineup for the second time this year after an injury.
Hopefully he remains healthy instead of weird random injuries like getting his leg cut.
Yeah, well, and, you know, I'm hoping it's just a bad season for Boma. I mean, we're paying him quite a bit now. He's making, what, 2.4 this year?
2.2.
So I'm hoping that he can rebound, and maybe not this year, but next year, and live up to that deal.
Well, even at 2.2, it's not a big deal if he's struggling, so...
Not right now, but I mean, you know, if we can get the Lance Boma that we had last year back
yeah.
at 2.2, it's a great deal.
Oh, yeah. Well, I wasn't really expecting him to score 16 goals, but it would be good to have his presence and ability to bring some energy to the team through his usual shot blocking and other efforts. And I thought it was interesting in that Carolina game that both Josh Juris and Boma seemed to be feeding off of each other. Like, one would throw a hit, and the other guy's like, oh, well, I can do that too. And it seemed to pump both of them up. So it'll be interesting to see if that becomes a decent pairing, which on the other lines, it seems to be a center and a winger. So it'd be interesting if the Flames could get two wingers going together.
Yeah, and I think Boma's going to help not so much the power play, but the penalty kill as we go forward mm-hmm. as well. And so that's going to help bring up the special teams numbers a little bit more.
Yeah, I think that his being out for pretty much the entire season is one of the reasons why the Flames' penalty kill is dead last.
Also in that Hurricanes game, we saw the Flames switch goaltenders, and I wasn't surprised based on what was going on. It wasn't so much Ramos' fault, but just trying to spark the team. But what I did find weird, and I don't know if you noticed this, the backup goalie sits across the ice from the rest of the team in Carolina.
Yeah, it's the same thing in San Jose.
I think Montreal, too.
It's a little bizarre. Yeah, it's a little bizarre.
I'm really surprised that the league allows that. Like, you think they'd have a standard size for benches.
Yeah, well, it is whatever the architect likes to make it, so.
I'd be kind of lonely if I was the backup over there.
Well, I remember one of the Flames goalies at one point, the backup actually getting a hot dog delivered to him. So,
that's fantastic.
Yeah, so why not?
And from what I saw, it doesn't look like there's a lot of glass around the goal either. Like,
they're
pretty much exposed to the fans. It's not like the penalty box where there's, you know, 12-foot glass around them.
Yeah, no. And, like, that would be even more... lonely. Like, here's a little penalty box bench for yourself.
You've been penalized for not being the starter.
Yeah. Now everybody can point and laugh.
I'd want to look in there. Like, I'm wondering if it's like a major league bullpen where there's like a phone in there so you can call your backup. I don't know how that would work.
You'd probably just point to him and say, hey, get over here.
You just hope he's not busy paying the hot dog man at that point.
Yep. I can't go in, man. I just got my hot dog.
That's right. Can he stay in for another 2 minutes? I got to scarf this thing down. And then I'm going to have cramps, so I got to wait another 5 minutes.
Yeah, you just see him skating across the ice eating the hot dog.
Or you give it to the other guy. All right, hey, you've been pulled. Eat this hot dog. It's sitting over there for you. I just ordered it. I thought it was good to see that the Flames had the confidence in Hiller. And I thought Hiller, you know, played pretty well for the back half of the game. But I think even, you know, 3 weeks ago, we wouldn't have even seen that change made. Like, they seem to have just lost all confidence in Hiller. And now it seems like the team's willing to look at him as an option.
Well, he hasn't played poorly in any of the games recently. So why not? Before, he was playing downright terrible. And... that's why he didn't see the ice for a month. So if he is a legitimate secondary option, then why not throw him out? It's not like Ramo, since he returned, has been playing very good himself either. So we'll see.
Both of our goaltenders are unrestricted free agents at the end of the year. The Flames are going to have to decide what they want to do there. I think that you and I would probably both agree that we have nobody else in the system ready to take over a starting role. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, and even in the backup role, like outside of maybe Kevin Poulin, I don't really see any legitimate options internally as a backup even.
So if we look at the Flames, and I mean, we can get more in depth in this, you know, as we get close to the deadline and after and see what happens. But as far as the two NHL goaltenders now, if you were the general manager of this team, do you re-sign either one of them?
I would probably wait until closer to July 1st just to, because you can negotiate with other goaltenders around the league, any UFA. In the week right after the draft.
Yeah, between the draft and free agency opening.
So I would probably leave it until then and contact the handful of UFAs that might be interested in and interesting to bring in and see what they're looking at and then making a decision. I would probably let Jonas Hiller walk regardless. The player that I would possibly bring back is Ramo.
You think Ordeo gets let go?
Yeah, I think his time in the organization's done.
And you and I were looking before we came on the show tonight just to see what names were out there as far as goaltenders are available. And there's a lot of goaltenders, but few goaltenders who you would look at as, you know, your next starter. And I think the Flames are in a good spot right now that we don't need, as we've said, that next franchise goalie right away. But some of the names that are going to be available... we had Jonas Gustafsson, we had Ranta, Jan Denis is back somehow, Backstrom, Lindback, Cam Ward, James Reimer, Anton Khudobin, Michael Leeton, Jason LaBarbera, Ben Scrivens, Al Montoya, Jonas Enroth, Carter Hutton. So a lot of guys that have made their career as backups, made their career as AHL guys. To me, if I look at that list, the only two guys I could see kind of taking over as the Flames starter next year, actually three, would be Reimer, Ranta, or potentially Cam Ward. What about you?
Yeah, I agree on all counts. Potentially Jonas Enroth as well. I've always liked Enroth. He's a shorter guy, but he's overcomes that by being really good. It's just that he's also, I think he's like 5'10", 5'11", so... Even though he's good, his height and lack of size does tend to allow more goals to be scored on him. Personally, if I was to pick one guy on that list, it would be Antti Raanta. But if the Flames ended up getting either Cam Ward or James Reimer as a temporary starter, that would be perfectly fine as well.
To me, I think for me, Ranta and Reimer would be my first two. I think Reimer might be well-suited with a change of scenery, and I think coming into a Flames team with less expectation next year, he might, not saying he's going to get to the playoffs, but he might be just what we need for next year.
Mm-hmm. Can't argue with that.
I can see the Flames, if he'll do it, re-signing Kari Ramo to a 1 or 2 year deal and still bringing in potentially a James Reimer or Cam Ward or Antti Raanta, or even somebody like an Al Montoya, and making those guys compete for the starter role.
Mm-hmm. And you never know. It might be one of those situations where you ditch both guys and you bring in two UFAs. And like a guy like Enroth, you bring him in with one of the better guys like Reimer or...
Yeah, I could see something like that, like a Reimer Enroth or even like a Ranta Montoya pairing.
Yeah, something like that where go nuts, see what, you know, we'll let you guys decide who's the starter and the backup.
And I mean, the Flames got a pretty good deal on Ramo this year on a 1 year. I can't see him wanting another 1 year deal next year. And to me, if he wants a long-term deal, I'd let him move on.
Same here.
I don't think
anything more than 2 years, I would just let him walk.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if I'm True Living, I would have that discussion with him and say, look, we like you. We think you're the guy for now. We have to try different options. You know, we tried Hiller. That didn't work out. We're going to bring in a James Reimer or Cam Ward or, you know, somebody like that. And as I've said in the past, I believe that Ramo does better when he has pressure and when he's challenged. And I think any one of those guys would do that. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't want to see a Lobarbera or a Michael Leighton or, you know, a Yondini or Peter Budaj. Any of these guys that are sort of...
There.
Well, I don't want to call them has-beens, but they've all had their day.
Yeah, they're just there. They're not going to blow you away.
They might be a decent AHL backup to, you know, work with the Gillies or somebody like that. I could also see the Flames getting rid of both of our goaltenders, bringing in, say, James Reimer and promoting Kevin Poulin.
That's also a possibility.
I think they want him to be around the organization. I don't think Poulin was brought in just as a temporary fill-in for a year. And he does have some NHL experience. And with where the Flames are at, I don't think it would be the worst thing to give him a shot.
No.
I don't think you'd give him a shot in, you know, 40 to 60 starts in the year.
No, but like a 15-20 starter, maybe more, depending on his level of play. Why not?
I would not be surprised if Poulin became the backup. There's a lot of options out there, but I just can't see the Flames going out and bringing in two brand new goalies at the same time. So, yeah, I think Ranta... I would be more likely to go with Reimer over Ward. I think Cam Ward might be a bit past his best before date.
Well, I think Ward is basically in that same boat as Hiller. They're just there. You know what you're getting. Just a solid 1B type goalie. Average starter. Not going to blow you away.
I think Cam Ward would be the choice from that list for me if we had somebody like Ordeo, who we said, this is the new heir apparent. You know, Cam Ward, you're here as a teacher and a backup and a mentor.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at that list, I agree. Ward would be that guy, that veteran support guy. But if we don't have that young up-and-coming goaltender, and I can't see anyone trading us one, so we're going to have to go find that guy. But without that guy, I don't think I would bring Cam Ward in. I'd rather do a Reimer Ranta pair or Reimer Montoya. I might even be willing to take a chance at a Reimer Scrivens pair.
Yeah, I can't argue with any of that. So
it'll be interesting to see, but yeah.
There are plenty of options. It pretty much what it'll come down to is, are the players willing to come to Calgary? A, how much are they willing to take? And how long would the contracts be? And I think that will, all of that will be determined between the draft and July 1st. I could even see us bringing back Ramo or Hiller, like how Ramo was signed just prior to UFA opening this year.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be Hiller. I think Hiller's time in the NHL is done.
Yeah.
At least for a couple years. I can see somebody picking him up. I don't know, a few years from now, and maybe giving him a shot somewhere down the road, almost like...
Well, if he's willing to be a backup, I think there might be some teams that are willing. Like, sort of like Buffalo when they got Leonard and they had Chad Johnson. Like, I think if he's willing to be that veteran backup to the young guy, I think some team might be interested, but...
I'm also not...
It depends.
...ruling out the possibility that the Flames make a one-for-one trade between now and the deadline of trading Ramo for Reimer. I think both goalies could use a change of scenery, and it might make sense for both teams. If we're both out, why not swap netminders and see if, you know, each other wants what the other has? I don't see Carey Ramo wanting a 1 or 2 year deal. I can see him finally... He's 29. I can see him kind of wanting to find his... I don't want to say his forever home in the NHL, but someone who's going to take him on for 4 years until he's, you know, an older guy. I don't want that to be Calgary. So as much as I think it'd be good to keep him on and bring in somebody else like Reimer, Ward, or Ranta, I have a feeling that Carey Ramo is going to be moving on.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm fine with that, but it leaves us back in the position of needing, especially if Ordeo moves on, it leaves us in that position of needing another young goaltender.
And that's why I think the Flames might target Ranta, just because of the fact that he's one of the youngest UFAs. So, 26, I think. So.
Yeah, and Ramo's 29. Yeah, you're right, Ranta's 26. So you could be right. I mean, you bring him in, you pay him starter money and you bring somebody else in around him as a complimentary guy. And Ranta doesn't need to get us to the playoffs, mm-hmm. but if he can, you know, keep us in games, I think that's enough for him. If I had Ranta, I might be more likely than to bring in a Cam Ward or an Al Montoya, somebody who has a bit more experience to back him up.
I can agree with that.
You know, I don't know that I'd want, say, a Ranta-Poulin pair.
No. And I can agree with you there as well. I think with that, like, even a guy like retaining Hiller might not even be a terrible option at that rate.
I think you would retain, if you're going to retain Hiller, you have to be willing to have a small enough deal you're willing to send it to the AHL if you need to.
Yeah, like a one-year, $2 million contract or something like that.
Yeah, because, I mean, Hiller's making quite a bit now, and I think his big earning days in the NHL are behind him. I would say I wouldn't bring him back for any more than two.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's Hiller, I wouldn't do more than a one-year. Like, I want to be able to dump him at the end of next year if we need to. I don't think either Flames goalie right now is going to bring enough at the deadline to make a trade. I mean, unless you're trading for another, you know, expiring goalie piece, just try something different. But looking around,
I think at most that you would get a third round pick or something similar, and that's like at most.
Yeah, and with the other pieces we can move, I'm not sure it's worth making that deal unless they want to bring Poulin up to see what he's got.
And that would be the only situation I could see that working.
Talking about another, anything else about the goalies you want to talk about?
Nah. Let's carry on. We only got 20 minutes until the Flames game starts. So.
I think at this point, and I was thinking about this today, Hudler's looked, well, let's be honest, Hudler's looked terrible this year. He's not the Jiri Hudler from last year. If we could get Hudler at a reasonable cost because he's taken a dive, let's say we could sign him for less than we have him this year, do you think he'd be worth bringing back, or is it just time to move on?
That would be another situation that I'd probably leave until just before the UFA day. And the reason being is if there are options out there, like say you want to sign Kyle Okposo or Louis Erickson, and they're both willing and their contracts aren't terrible, I would probably go in that direction instead. If not, then I would talk with Hudler and see what he's looking at. If, say, like, he wants, like, a three-year deal at, say, $13 or $14 million, I'd probably go with that if the other options are either not willing to come or going to be too ridiculous. Like, say, Okposo wants $8 million, then no. But
to me, I think that Hudler's stock has dropped so much this year that I don't even think we're going to get much better than a fourth rounder for him at the deadline.
No, I don't see that. I think at least a second. Even though he's struggling, I don't. I think I'd keep him the rest of the year if the only thing we're getting is a fourth.
Yeah, if that's all we can get, I'd keep him. If we can get a second, I'd move him and then just talk to him again before July 1st and say, hey, you want to come back? But, yeah. You know, if the market's only a fourth-round pick, hang on to the guy. But for a second, I'd deal him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think that. I think that teams are looking at his 76-point season a year ago. And, like, even though he's struggling this year, I think that, hey, this guy was only 1 year away from being one of the top 10 scorers in the NHL.
Similar to what we saw with the Glenn Cross trade.
Yeah, and he might not be doing great this year, but if he gets the right chemistry, maybe he's going to be right back at it. So
yeah, he can add some depth to our team as we go into the playoffs, that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. And he's won a Stanley Cup, yada, yada, yada. So
that's true.
He wouldn't be a bad second, third line player for a contending team. So I'm pretty sure that some team out there, like a Dallas or whomever, you know what I mean.
Yeah, and we've talked about where we can see him going. We're about a month away from the deadline, so it'll be curious to see what happens in the next month here as far as him moving or not moving. And speaking of a month to the deadline, that means that we're also within that period of the All-Star Game. We're a week out from the NHL All-Star Game, and the Flames are represented by two players this year, Mark Giordano and Johnny Gaudreau, the same two as last year. Matt, you and I were looking at an interesting article today from matchsticksandgasoline.com talking about every Flame that's ever been in the All-Star Game, even back when this team was an Atlanta Flames team, and you had some interesting observations.
Yeah, apparently Johnny Gaudreau, with his multi-point game last year, became only the fifth Flame to score more than 1 point in an All-Star game. Joe Nieuwendyk in 1989, Theo Fleury three times in 92, 98, and 99, Val Bure in 2000, and Jerome McGinley also did it. So it's interesting to see that even though he was a rookie last year, he became only the fifth Flame to hit the score sheet twice.
I think it's interesting if you look at the guys that have represented this team at the All-Star Games since 1980, you can see these distinct kind of groupings and eras within, and I imagine this is true of most players, but you know, we see starting in about 83, we've got Lanny McDonald going twice as our only representative. Then we sort of get into the Al McInnes, Paul Reinhardt era. Reinhardt went once, and McInnes and Suter keep going. Then we get Joe Nieuwendyk added in, and McInnes falls out, and, you know, Theo Fleury's added in. And then the weirdest one was in 2000. Our representatives were Phil Housley and Val Bure. And then we get into Jerome, and then Dion joins them, Kipper joins them for 1 year, and now we're into sort of the Gaudreau-Giordano era. But I think it's sort of interesting to look at these clumps of, you know, we've had very few different guys go to the All-Star game, but we've had a lot of guys return over 3-4 years in a row.
Yeah, and I'm expecting that Gaudreau will be a perennial candidate for quite a long time. Pretty much as long as he's a Flame, he'll be at least our only representative, if not one of many.
I'm hoping so. And, you know, as bad as the Flames have been over the years, we've pretty much been represented by somebody at the All-Star game every year.
Well, didn't they used to have a rule that everybody had to have at least one guy?
Did they?
Yeah.
I don't know. So, was that before the fan voting?
Yeah, I have no idea when.
That must have been the year that Phil Housley and Val Bure ended up going.
Yeah.
Because 2001.
Well, I remember one year Peter Bouzek was an all-star, so you know that.
And this year, John Scott's an all-star.
Yeah, under normal circumstances. And how bad does it feel to be a Coyotes fan? You've got this young upcoming team, and your only all-star representative is John Scott, who doesn't even play for you anymore.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what logo he wears in his jersey. Because they usually wear their team logo on the arm.
Yeah, I wonder if he'll be sporting the Hamilton Bulldogs jersey.
Who knows? Or just put a big question mark there. We have no idea where this guy plays or who he's representing. He's just here.
Yeah. The designated all-star.
Yeah.
Maybe he should get Mark Scheifele's draft jersey.
That could work.
Yeah, when it was just like the NHL logo and that's it.
And I don't know what your thoughts about the All-Star jerseys this year. This is always a topic of contention. I like them a lot better than last year's. At least we have a regular-looking NHL logo.
What, you don't like the neon green?
Ugh. I was not a fan.
Yeah, those were the worst All-Star jerseys, I think, ever. So
I still think the best idea would be to base the All-Star jersey design off the host team jersey.
Yeah, I could see that.
You know, use different colors or whatever you want to do, but base it off the host team's jersey. Like, I think that the Predators have a decent-looking jersey template, and I'd like to see, I'd like to see them wear something similar to that.
Mm-hmm.
I think it makes it collectible then, too. You know, if you're going to that game, you'd probably be more likely to buy that jersey. I know if the game was here and they wore last year's monstrosity, I wouldn't have bought one.
No. No, and I agree. That's actually a good concept. It's sort of like what they did that one year when they played in Minnesota and they had that retro throwback style, like the Wilds jerseys at the time.
Yeah. Yeah, like, I've never really liked any of the All-Star jerseys. I can't think of one I really liked. And I think if they based it off the home team's, you know, darks and lights, it would be cool. And it would show you where that game was. Like, you could look at a jersey and be like, oh, that game was in Raleigh, or that game was in Calgary, or wherever it might have been.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that would be kind of cool.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how the actual game itself goes with it being 3-on-3 for the entire game.
What do you think of that format, Matt?
Well, over time, it seems, because I've been watching a handful of other teams' games lately and that have coincidentally gone into overtime, and we're kind of lucky that the Flames are really good at overtime 3-on-3, because a lot of the other teams, it's really boring.
Are the Flames good, or is Johnny Hockey good?
Both. So, like, a lot of the other teams, most of the overtime is really a boring trap fest, and with the team just skating around trying to find an opening, and then turning it over, and then the puck goes the other way, and it's the same thing. So, I don't know. It'll be interesting to see, especially with the best players being out there, if it's going to be more like the Flames 3-on-3 overtime, or, say, like the Sharks game from last night.
What would you, if you were Gary Bettman and you could fix the All-Star game or change it in whatever way you want, what would you like All-Star Weekend to look like?
I think it's pretty good now. I like that they're trying new ideas for the game itself. I think that would be the best time to try out new ideas for rules and such that might be done in the future. A one game tryout type of thing, and why not? It's the All-Star game. I don't really put too much emphasis on it. Like, I don't even usually watch the All-Star game, so.
We've talked in the past about, you know, putting some sort of weight on the All-Star game, you know, making it so that the team that won or the conference that won got some sort of advantage in the Stanley Cup or something like that. I've been thinking about it, and I've thought with the World Cup of Hockey coming back, I would be okay if they were to scrap the All-Star game and just do a skills competition and really use the World Cup to show off the best players in the NHL.
Yeah, I don't really, like, when they play in the Olympic years, there is no All-Star game, so I wouldn't even be opposed if they just scrapped the All-Star game entirely.
What's I'm saying, take the game out and, you know, do something for the fans, because it probably brings in some revenue for the host team. So, you know, do a skills comp or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And take the game out. That way everybody gets some rest. It's not that physically intensive to do a skills competition. And, you know, I don't know, put some new games into it, or make it silly and fun, something like that. Or even have, like, a rookie team versus their veterans team and make them compete and see, you know, can the rookies beat the vets at the skills comp, something like that.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I don't think 3-on-3 is the way to go. I mean, I'm not a huge fan of the whole overtime format as is. I'm glad it's not a shootout competition.
Yeah.
But to me, hockey is a 5-on-5 game, and if we're going to show it off, if there's going to be our all-star game, we should show it off as a 5-on-5 game.
Yeah, I can't argue with you. I like that they're trying new things. I just don't know. We'll see. I'd have to actually watch the game in order to give a proper verdict on it. So
we'll talk about our thoughts after the All-Star game. But
yeah.
Just looking at the format, and especially the fan voting, I think there's a lot that's broken about it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, and that'll get changed. Because I think John Scott will be the last of the players that aren't really All-Star caliber talents to play in the All-Star game.
Yeah, and I'd be okay if every team wasn't represented, but even if there was some sort of milestones, if anyone that hits a certain milestone is automatically in the All-Star game, and then have kind of, you know, sub-milestones from there based on how many guys are left.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. We'll see how it goes. But I'm not looking forward to this year's, but I'm going to watch it and see how it is.
Yeah.
At least it's better than the Pick'em style we've had in the past. Matt, let's talk about the Stockton Heat for a bit. We talked a little bit about them last week. Stockton has 3 wins in a row, dating back since last Sunday. They're 7-2-1 in their last 10 and finally closing in on a playoff spot. They're not in the cellar anymore. The interesting thing is they're 5 points out of a playoff spot and they've played significantly fewer games. You were noting that one of the teams has played 10 games more. That seems crazy to me.
Yeah, Texas, they've played 45 games and Stockton's played 35, even though they're in the same division. So the whole games played is going to be one of the things. Like, once Calgary or Stockton starts getting their games in, I think the standings will close in. In terms of point percentage, they're still the second worst team in their division, but they're not far off any of the 3 or 4 teams ahead of them. So we'll see.
Well, I remember that Stockton hardly played in the first month and a bit of the season.
Mm-hmm. And the Flames the Heat have been getting significantly better goaltending. And in the 2 games that they played this week, they pretty much destroyed the Manitoba Moose. I think in each game they had over 50 shots, and they ended up winning each game in overtime, and that was mainly due to the goaltenders standing on their head for the Moose. Otherwise, each game should have been like an 8-1 score.
That's good to hear.
Yeah, it was basically a turkey shoot. It was the one team was just all over them.
I like to hear that the AHL team is having success and training those players to have success, because that's really what you want. I would rather have the Flames do terrible and the AHL team win the Calder Trophy, because to me that shows that these guys are learning how to win at an early age and will bring that with them when they eventually get promoted.
Yeah, and if you look at games prior to this week, they've been scoring a lot more. There's a 7-6 game, there was a 7-4 game. So they're getting a lot more goals, and even though they only scored 5 this week in the 2 games, they were still, if the score was representative of how they were playing, it should have been like 8 or 9 in each game. So,
and it sounds like Kevin Poulin has pretty much been handed the net down in Stockton.
Yeah. Yanni Ordeo, in his last 2 starts, I do believe, has given up 10 goals.
That's
he did
crazy.
Collect a win in one of them. So he's been kind of iffy when he's in net. Prior to that, he was doing pretty good, but he's still very inconsistent from start to start. So
it's crazy, because if you look at what we saw from him when he got called up last year,
he was good. And then even in the AHL last year, you and I both watched most of the games, and he was really good down there. But this year, it's just he's all over the place.
Yeah, and we've always said, oh, he's a slow starter, he'll come around, but he's never really come around.
No, and the team also plays significantly different when he's in net. It's sort of like they're on pins and needles because he's in net, and if they screw up, they'll make, the pucks in the net. So the fact that Poulin's been in net, he's really been a steadying force for Stockton, and I think if he continues to play, I could see the Flames moving out one of their goaltenders at the deadline and bringing him in as a temporary addition to see if he could be the backup for next year.
Yeah, well, I think it just gives us that much more in terms of options. You know, it's like, okay, we don't have to bring Ordeo up. There's another chance and another guy who we could bring up to, a chance to get some good goaltending for the rest of the year. We should probably get out of here pretty quick. The Flames are about to drop the puck with Dallas, so let's do our weekly predictions for this week. As always, these predictions are brought to you by TickTix. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so the buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. And you can download TickTix in the Google Play or iOS stores. So grab your tickets for an upcoming Flames game. They've got some more home games coming up in February and enjoy your time at the Dome. Hopefully we'll see a turnaround from this team. Matt, it's a slow week. Two games this week, 4 points on the board. The Flames play the Dallas Stars tonight, and they play the Nashville Predators at home on Wednesday. And then we have the All-Star break. What's your prediction? Actually, I'll go first. We got 4 points on the board. I'm going 3 points this week. I think we'll get one against Dallas tonight, and we'll beat Nashville. What's your thought?
I'm going to go with the same as I had a week ago and 0 points. I think that the Flames are still struggling from period to period, game to game, and Dallas and Nashville are too good of teams to have that inconsistency.
Last time we played, well, we've had some success against Dallas this year, and that's the only reason I think they might walk out with a point tonight.
Yeah. Oh, very well could be. We're usually good against both teams. It's just I haven't been liking what I've been watching recently of the Flames, so that's why I'm saying that 0 for this week.
And last week there was 6 points on the board, 3 games. I thought the Flames would get 4 points. I thought they'd beat Carolina and Columbus. They did. Columbus couldn't beat the Hurricanes, and you went for the big goose egg again. So neither of us got a point last week.
Yep. I'm hoping that you're right, so that way the Flames can build off of that after the All-Star break. I just... the Flames have to put up and play consistent hockey, and I just haven't seen that, so we'll see.
On our way out this week, I just wanted to take a minute, and you'd mentioned this as well, to thank George Johnson and Randy Sportick for everything they've done as Flames reporters. George Johnson worked for the Herald for years and Randy Sportick for the Sun. Both of them are no longer going to be covering the Flames due to cuts in the newspaper industry, which we all knew were coming eventually. Both guys have, I don't know if they've been let go or just reassigned.
I do believe they were let go, and I don't know. I don't like seeing bad things happening to good people, and both of these guys are very good people, so I'm hoping that they are able to land on their feet and find another opportunity elsewhere in the media sphere and be able to resume contributing to, if not Flames coverage, NHL coverage.
There's a lot of terrible people in the hockey sphere. These guys will get picked up by somebody. I mean, you know, they can go blog for one of the blog sites. They could be radio correspondents. I'm pretty confident they'll both find some work.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's probably good to take a rest now and use that time. But, yeah, I think you're going to start seeing some high-profile blogs come out, more than we are seeing right now, and someone who might have the budget to bring one of these guys in. Well, Matt, I think that's about it for this week. Enjoy the two games and the All-Star break, and we will talk to you next week.
Thank you for listening, everybody. Have an awesome week, and we'll see you after the All-Star break.
Have a good one, Matt.
Bye.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.